Hi, and welcome to another edition of Homegrown. Today we're going to visit the Jorgensen Land and Cattle Company near Ideal, South Dakota. We're going to talk all about their world-class Angus breeding operation and bull sale, and we're also going to learn a lot about their family history and the lineage not only of their bulls, but also of their family. Obviously, you guys have a lot of irons in the fire. We pull up to this wonderful office building and this grand lodge, and it's, you know, not probably your typical little old farmstead from 60 years ago. So just tell us all the different enterprises and things that are going on here in Jorgensen.
Right. Well, if you look at our logo, and this was kind of hard to see, but in the center diamond is really the cattle aspect of it, which is really and truly the economic driver of our operation. It's really about 80% of our revenue base, okay? And then on either side of that diamond, we have the wheat, which signifies the crops, which is integrated as part of that system. This can't survive without this. This can't survive without this. And the third diamond is the recreational, the hunting. So, and that's really the ag tourism side of it. And so between those three, that encompasses our operation. How it's managed has really changed fundamentally in the last several years. So the four partners, myself, my son Nick, my nephew Cody, and my brother Greg, all have distinctive personalities and distinctive roles in that operation. I'm the chief agronomy operations officer, and I have a director of operations below me that runs the operational side of what I do. I plan, I purchase, I sell, and execute all those things to my director of ops, and he takes care of that. I don't worry about the day-to-day minutiae of what goes on. Cody is structured the same way. He's the chief livestock operations officer. Nicholas is our CEO and our CFO, so he handles all the numbers. He's basically our boss. He kind of keeps everything orchestrated. And Greg is on his way out. My brother Greg is on his way out to retire, and I'm soon behind him. I'm not very far behind him, but he is extremely important in that he does a lot of our marketing in our southern Gulf states in the wintertime. And so he has a huge role in terms of making the sales happen. And so going back to where we started, my grandfather, Martin Sr. Jorgensen, was of Danish descent. He came over when he was 19 years old, and he ended up in White Lake, about an hour and a half east of here, and ultimately he staked a claim in Murdo back in the early 1900s. Meanwhile, he had met his bride-to-be, who actually had staked a claim here in Ideal in 1909. And he came back to Ideal, started raising a family with Gertrude, his wife. And that homestead actually is about 3 miles south of our existing headquarters. And so they raised 7 kids there. And my dad, Martin Jr., was the second to youngest. And so World War II came, and most of the family, the boys, one of which passed away when he was a child, but the two other of the three boys went off to war. Stanley, unfortunately, never came home. He was shot down. He was a navigator in a B-24. He was shot down over France. My Uncle Don was a merchant marine, and he did come home, and he and my dad got into partnership. My dad stayed home during the war because he was the only son left. Grandpa Sr., or Grant Martin Sr., Grandpa was unable to handle all the duties of the farm, so my dad was able to stay home. My dad basically took that farm over when he was 19 years old. So he and my uncle were in partnership until 1977, at which time my brother Greg had graduated from college and been married, came back, and he bought out my Uncle Don. And so he and my father were partners in Jorgensen Farms until about 1987, when I came back from college and I got involved. I wasn't the part of the operation, but I was definitely in the management role and doing the crops and different things. And then that leads us up to about 2000 when we formed Jorgensen Land and Cattle Partnership, and at which time Cody became involved. Fortunate in that my father was a visionary in many regards, but one of the things that he saw and understood was allowing the younger people to come in and take ownership and take on responsibility. He was firm, he was tough, but he held us accountable for our mistakes.
Right.
But he gave us an opportunity to lead and to be responsible for certain aspects of the operation. I mean, even today, we try and carry that forward. My son Nicholas is 30 years old, and he's our CEO and our CFO of a pretty large company. So he has proven that he has the ability to lead, he has the ability to take on those responsibilities, and I think it's really important in order to transition that business into the next generation, you have to be able to forgive and let those younger people do that. I'm learning now as I transition out, and I'm starting to transition out of this operation. In five, six years, I'll probably be out. And so that's tough. I'm beginning to understand how hard it is to give up certain things that I'm so used to doing and so love to do. But that's all part of the evolution of an operation. And, and I think that's what makes the next generation better, is to give them the opportunity.
My responsibility focuses around the day-to-day, you know, financials, make sure that we're running a strong, sound, sustainable business. Mm-hmm. And then the strategy and leadership part, right? So as we sit down and think about our business as a family, I kind of take the reins, not in setting the direction that we go, right? I mean, that's a family endeavor, right? Us deciding.
It's almost like a board decision.
What we want Jorgensen Land and Cattle to be, but then it's my job then to make sure that we follow through with with getting where we want to go, right? So it's an interesting place to be in, because they call me a CEO, right? But you're never really a CEO to your dad,
right?
That's not a thing in the traditional sense of a CEO, right? I don't think you could ever be a CEO to someone who changed your diapers,
right?
Yeah, in my opinion. So really what it winds up being is, like you mentioned, it's kind of a board decision. The family gets together as we think about the future of Jorgensen Land and Cattle, and we come to agreement on where we want the hunting operation to go, right, or the farming operation, or the cattle side of the business. We come to agreement together on that, as equals, right? Mm-hmm. And then once we get that decision made, it becomes my responsibility to then sit down with, say, Dad individually and say, all right, so how are we gonna make sure that what we wanna do on the agronomy side takes place? How are we actually gonna do that? Tell me what you think, and then I'll hold you accountable to what your goals are. And I do the same thing with Cody, and then, you know, we kind of decide things that way on the lodge side as well.
It looks all wonderful and rosy, but there's got to be some tense situations too, where you guys don't always get along or you disagree, and that's got to be a little bit tough. I mean, especially you being the youngest partner out of all four of them.
Yep.
But yet it seems like they're really trying to let you do your thing and be an equal partner and give you a lot of rein to do what you need to do on a day-to-day basis.
Yeah, it comes along with difficulties, and I'm not gonna say that we don't have our share, but I think the part that helps us power through all that and, you know, keeps us from just putting our hands in the air and saying, all right, well, then we're, let's just be done, is that we really are a family, you know what I mean? And so it makes it all worth it.
And what I've seen, when you say that word family, in the truest sense of the word, going back, not just to your dad and your uncle, but generations, and they have instilled that in you guys and really built that foundation that is really, you know, you've seen some really awesome things flourish from that.
Yeah, and you know, you mentioned, you know, those guys talking highly about giving me latitude to do what I want, but I want to express that respect for our roles is mutual.
You mentioned some of the newer technology that you're using to run these cattle more efficiently in some different areas. And so why don't you just explain what we're looking at here and how that works.
So this is a Vence G GPS cow collar. They call it the Cattle Rider. And what this unit is it's a collar that goes around the animal's neck and functions very similarly to a invisible fence that you'd put on a dog. So this collar sits on their neck, right? So if you can envision their head kind of rides like this, and you know, those prods got to make contact with the skin, and then so like you can envision this line here being the fence. She's walking up, she gets a certain distance away, this thing starts beeping. You can hear it beep, 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 beep. And then eventually they'll get so close. I mean, you can just see I've heard people, I've never felt it. I've never been shocked by one of these because I keep my hands away from the part that shocks you. But I've heard of people that have been, and they say it's less than an electric fence. And we're training an animal on this, right? Because you gotta think about from an animal's perspective, they have no idea, what's going on, right? So you gotta teach them. And how we do that is we put these collars on them in a pasture that's got physical fence on all sides. So if you can envision this right here as a physical fence, we build the vents shock collar, right? The invisible fence right, if you can envision this, right on the inside of the real fence. And so how it works is when she's walking up to this real fence, hears the sound, gets close, gets the shock. When she gets that, what are her options? She does not have the ability to move forward, right? Which is exactly what we don't want. So she sees that fence, she gets the stimulus. Her only option is to back up or go sideways. So right away, you are encouraging that behavior of getting them to turn.
Right.
They're getting them to turn. So we train them on this, and then they learn, okay, I'm hearing that beep. They get to the point where just the beep alone is enough to say, okay, I'm getting close to a place where this is gonna hurt.
You're going somewhere
else. And they go somewhere else. And when you look at the entirety of the Jorgensen Land and Cattle property that we own or manage, it's technology like this that'll open up about 6,000 acres of grazing forest that we haven't historically had. Wow. Whether that's grass, like I mentioned, or farm ground that we'd like to turn cattle out to graze stocks or residues. You know, technology like this allows us to maybe say take a quarter of land that has no fence or very poor fence around it and make it usable.
Right.
And so you look at, the cost of doing something like this, right? I mean, it's an investment. It costs us about $35 to $40 a head.
Okay.
Or per collar per year to use these.
Sure.
So, we got an investment there in these collars, but then when you think about what that did for us, 1,100 acres of grass and basically new ground to summer an entire heifer crop on, phenomenal investment in my opinion. Really is a phenomenal investment in my opinion. My part of the business is to come and talk to you about the financial impacts that has for us.
Sure.
And in my opinion, and maybe I'm biased because this is what I do all day is I talk financials, it's probably the most significant part is the benefit to our bottom line to doing something like that, right? So you put a collar or you got a good fence on a piece of farm ground and you put a bull out there, saves us $1.50 a day in feed costs, which isn't big, that's a small number, until you look at right now today we've got 1,200 bulls out grazing.
Yeah.
And we can do that for 90 days. And all of a sudden that number gets really, really big.
Yeah.
Right? And that's something, once again, that goes right to the bottom line of our business because it's a feed savings. And then you stack on, all right, you got healthier soil, which there's even, we can put financials to that too, right?
Sure.
Better yield, stuff like that. And you've got a healthier animal. I mean, I have yet to see a downside. I've got a whole rabbit hole I could take you down about, what the future state of this deal might look like. And that just, I'll leave it at it's exciting in my opinion, right?
Yeah, I'm really excited about
where we're going. And, it really is that cow-calf portion of what we do is ultimately kind of the heart of Jorgensen Land and Cattle.
Right.
We are in the cattle business,
you look
right?
around and you guys have been raising Angus bulls for 50 years.
Yep. And right, that goes back to that herd of Angus cows that we've had on this ranch. I mean, everything stems out from there.
Yep.
The whole bull leasing program, the smart bull program, we can do what we want on the hunting side because we've got that strong business based in those cows.
Right.
Right. And so anything we can do to manage those as efficiently and good as possible, we're gonna do it.
Are some of our, what I would consider our very best cows. We classify them as our elite cows. In addition to that, we merchandise about 4,200 bulls on an annual basis. And this set of cows here really controls those genetics for all 4,000 bulls that we that we sell. These girls in particular are cows that I've either flushed embryo transfer conventionally, or we've actually pulled oocytes off of them. Mm-hmm. And they've excelled in many different traits as individuals, and so we've identified them to be kind of the top end of our herd, and so now we're trying to propagate those genetics.
So what are some of those traits that you're looking for to really build them herds?
Yeah, it's actually a lot of different things. We try to be as balanced as possible. Really, there's, when you look at all of the indexes that we can have, that we have to study these cattle, there's over 50 of them.
Wow.
And so it's really my job not to just single trait select. It's,
sure.
It's my job to really analyze and find the best, that excel here, maybe not so good here, but really put them together and try to get the overall suite of EPDs to be above average. And again, it's our widget at Jorgensen Land and Cattle, if you will, really is the Black Angus bull. I mean, we market more bulls than anybody probably in the world.
Mm-hmm.
But when we look at those bulls, they are somewhat of a byproduct to these girls, right?
Right.
So if we can get this piece right, the cows, if we get them correct and get them right, then by default, our bulls are above average or superior.
Right.
And really, it's not about breeding the cows to make bulls. It's about breeding these cows to make other cows that make bulls.
Right.
That makes sense.
Because at the end of the day, 50% of your genetics are going to come from a cow.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. And Angus is known for lots of different things, carcass merit, but really at the end of the day, and people can argue this one way or the other, but I believe that the Black Angus cow is really one of the most trouble-free cows around, and that's why you see so many of them across the nation.
Well, one of the things we've also talked about a time or two is what you call cattle intimacy, and so we're sitting here, feet from these cows, grabbing, they're eating some cake, but they just ate one out of my hand. They're obviously pretty habituated to the human presence.
Yep.
I mean, you guys put an emphasis on that care for those animals.
It's extremely important to us. Yeah, if you're gonna have one running around your place, you surely don't want them, destructing or putting you in harm's way or anything
right.
like that. So it's really important to be intimate with them. And I love to study and analyze them, and that's just one good way to get, to be intimate with them really helps you understand, what you're trying to do with her
right.
as a cow.
And the only way there is to spend time with them. So you guys are out here spending time with them, and we're on, tell us what we're grazing right now.
Yeah, this is some forage wheat that we planted here probably a month and a half ago, 2 months ago. And we were fortunate enough to get some really good September rains.
Mm-hmm.
And it grew probably even a little too much if you would ask Brian. And so he asked if we could get some hooves out here to, kind of set it back. This will grow and we'll actually forage it. We'll chop it for silage in June sometime.
Okay.
And so it's not only are we grazing it in the fall, but we'll take it as forage. For every day that I have an animal out grazing the land versus in the lot, it saves us about $1.50 per head per day.
Right.
So if you think about that, I mean, if you have 1,000 animals out grazing rather than in a feed yard, now you're talking about some substantial money.
Right, $1,000 a day, that's a pretty good paycheck.
It is.
Yeah, absolutely.
These cows are what we consider, again, as our elite cows. And again, they'll control the genetics for the rest of the cows that are in our herd, which is about 1,000 head, all right? And then we have 15 cooperator herds that help create bulls for us. 15 other herds that are in Nebraska, South Dakota, and Montana. And they will come into this cow herd and select the very best genetics through bulls or through semen or whatever fits their management style.
Mm-hmm.
They will breed their cows from genetics from these cows. And we will then, in turn, buy those calves back at weaning time, grow them and develop them and test them just like we do our
sure.
own bulls from these cows.
Okay.
And so that's how we acquire so many bulls to market. So they are Jorgensen bred. That's kind
right.
of one of the prerequisites that we like to have. So obviously we're marketing a Jorgensen bull. We want it to be Jorgensen bred. So on top of that, we have our own genetic evaluation. It's called the IBE. So every animal that we have, every dose of semen that we have in our tanks from historic bulls that are no longer with us, have all been genomically tested, and the data resides in our own genetic evaluation.
Okay.
And a genetic evaluation is a lot like what breed associations have, where you would send them data, and then in turn, they would send you back a set of EPDs.
Right.
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 So we actually have our own genetic evaluation where we send in the phenotypes, the data, and we have a partnership, collaboration agreement with Zoetis, and they help us run this evaluation, and then we get the results back from every one of our animals that's in our system. Okay, so the benefits of this is that we control the data going into this evaluation.
Right.
We are, you know, it's our data. We want to know the bad just as much as we want to know the good. And so one of my goals then with this evaluation would be to offer a genetic test to our customers who get bulls from us, to have them go ahead and test their heifers,
right,
which gives me the upper hand in helping them select what bulls actually do mesh well with their
right
cover.
So you can take what their data, whether it's, you know, they need more carcass weight, or they need better marbling, or they need better weaning weights, or whatever, and then you can plug that into your system and say, I recommend this X, Y, and Z bull.
That's correct. Cool. And it wouldn't be just, you know, an assumption or a prediction. It would be a literal, I mean, this is DNA that matches with DNA. This is literally gonna make this better.
That's awesome.
And so that is the overall long-term genetic. And we call that, I know I've been saying a lot of acronyms here, but the ideal beef genetics concept is what we've named that.
Okay.
And so that's what we're gonna be offering to our clients to help them really better their herd and better their set of calves. Taylor Rides, just as well as any man.